Today we are going to talk about theft. Theft. And in the book Old Testament law, classified as in modern legal system by Roger Sermon Galen, attorney at law, and Timothy Toh, there were four general categories: public law, private law, religious law, and humane laws. This section covers two areas, public and private law. And it this section on the laws against theft addresses the eighth commandment. The eighth commandment in Exodus 20 verse 15 says, "Thou shalt not steal." And what does it mean to steal? This man, Rush Dooney, he defined it very well. He says, theft or stealing is taking another man's property by coercion, fraud, or without his uncoerced consent, cheating, harming property, or destroying its value is also theft. It is not necessary for the robbed to know of the theft for it to be a sin. Thus, to ride a train or bus without paying one's fare is theft, even though the transportation company is unaware of the act. Theft is one form of violation of God's fundamental order. Theft is more than an offense against persons, but against God. So this gives us a background concerning the eighth commandment. And what are the motivations for theft? Someone does not have possessed something and he wants it, and therefore he goes about getting it without the owner's permission to give it. That's stealing. Proverbs 13 verse 11 says, "Wealth gotten by vanity shall be diminished, but he that gathereth by labor shall increase." And so Proverbs 13:11 tells us that the means for gaining wealth is in human labor. That you work, and that honest work provides for you your wages. That's the most secure way, that's God's way in which we receive our increase. And this is again emphasized in the New Testament when the Apostle Paul said, "Let him that steal or that stole steal no more, but let him labor, working with his hands the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needed." So the godly pursuit of property and wealth as a result of honest labor is perfectly okay. If you have earned it, you buy something with what you have in your hand, well, that's God honoring. So Proverbs 13 verse 11 says, "Wealth gotten by vanity shall be diminished, but he that gathereth by labor shall increase." And so on Sunday when we had our adult Sunday school, remember Zechariah had a vision. That was vision 6. And he saw a robe, a flying robe. And in that flying robe he saw was written. What was written? Well, the sins of those who have stolen. It was a time of reckoning that was coming. And so here, as we think about it, this sin of theft, it's a picture of the fallen nature of man. And nations fight against nation. Theft, you call it robbery. Basically, you want to gain something that is not yours, doesn't belong to you. So the principle that we want to learn here as we seek to understand the remedy for theft is that to understand that God ordained work, and that is a consequence of the fall of man, recorded in Genesis 3:19. That man is to work in order to sustain his physical life. So human labor is that which is ordained of God to feed or sustain physically a man till the day he dies. From his labors, man will receive the fruit of his labor to feed and sustain his physical life. And this is grace to man, as it keeps him away from indulging in further sin as a result of the consequence of idleness. So when man fell, God said to Adam and Eve, "In the sweat of thy face thou shalt eat thy bread." In the sweat of thy face thou shalt eat thy bread. God sent thorns and thistles as a result of the curse that God pronounced upon the ground, that will manifest itself to, in a sense, impede the growth of the herbs in the field, so that Adam will have to spend more time to reap to have a good harvest. Paul said in 2 Thessalonians 3:12, "Now them that are such we command and exhort by our Lord Jesus Christ, that with quietness they work and eat their own bread. It is the will of God, the command and exhortation of our Lord Jesus Christ, that we are to work and enjoy the fruit of our labor." And so Paul went on to say in 2 Thessalonians 3 verse 10, "For even when we were with you, this we command you, that if any man would not work, neither shall he eat with their own hands at their proper callings, and so supported themselves to provide for their families and have something to give to them that are in need, by which means they shall live peaceable and quiet lives in godliness and honesty, and not disturb the peace of neighborhoods, churches, families. Eat their own bread, gotten by their own labor, bought with their money, and not the bread of others, or that of idols." And so with this background, we begin to explore. Okay? And we see that this laws for theft is firstly classified under public law. In the section Court and Legal Procedure, under the subheading Courts, and the item H, damages as a result of stealing. Okay. So, and in item 2, it is said here, item 2, Exodus 22, 1 and 4. "If a man shall steal an ox or a sheep and kill it or sell it, he shall restore 5 oxen for an ox and 4 sheep for a sheep. If the theft be certainly found in his hands alive, whether it be ox or ass or sheep, he shall restore double." This is the explanation from expense, OT expense. It says, this few verses deal with two aspects of a thief. What is stolen and when it is stolen. It is obvious that consideration is given for the value of what is stolen. The ox is worth more than its owners, worth more to its owners than a sheep. So if the thief has killed and sold the animal, the restitution, that means the payback, okay, would be higher than if the animal is found in the possession of the thief alive. Okay, so if the thief take the animal, kill the animal, sold it, he has to pay a lot more. Right? However, he was still to pay double or restore double when he was able to return whatever that he stole alive. Okay? There was a loss of time and service to the owner, so the extra must be restored. Okay? So that it would, the person who steals would realize that it's not worth his time. Right? He has to return whatever that he has stolen. Not just that, but he has to compensate for that which he didn't steal. Okay? So you see here, it's not worth it. Right? The law states it such that so a fine is imposed. Thirdly, it is also classified under in stealing. It's also classified under part 3, which is interesting, in Exodus 22, 5 and 6, it's speaking about kindling fire which damages property. And that's classified under stealing also. Okay? Kindling fire which damages property. Okay? If a man shall cause a field or vineyard to be eaten and shall put in his beast and shall feed in another man's field of the best of his own, of the best of his own vineyard, shall he make restitution. Okay? If a man cause a field to be eaten and shall put his own beast, so if someone else farm, you let your own animal in and create a havoc, eating what it did, then there is a price to be paid for such unruly behavior. And then a corollary is also placed here. So if fire break out, so we are thinking in terms of a farming agricultural community, that was their economy at the time. Okay. If fire break out and catch in thorns, so that the stacks of corn or the standing corn or the field be consumed therewith, he that kindled the fire shall surely make restitution. So here, these verses are classified rightly, Spence said, under neglect. This is simply a matter of neglect. If a person did not keep his animals shut up, and it caused the loss of grain in a field or fruit in a vineyard, then the owner of the animal would be responsible to restore with the very best of his own crop and fruit. So you see, this law would ensure that the owner of whatever animal would make sure that he keep his own animals in and not disturb the peace of his neighbor. If while burning thorns or weeds in a field, the fire spread to a standing corn. So he said that, you know, if you are trying to get rid of your weeds, and one of the best way to do so is to burn it. But as you burn it, if you are not careful, okay, and it affects the the well-being of your neighbor's farm. So this related. Then what happens? If while burning thorns and weeds in a field, the fire spread to a standing corn, and the person who kindled the fire would be responsible for the restoration of the loss. Okay, that's Spence. And Rush Dooney, yeah, he said very interesting, he said this. The restitution in all such cases depends on the nature of the act. If fruit trees or vines are damaged, then future production is damaged, and the liability is in proportion thereto. So he says that, you know, when you think about the compensation, you're not thinking just about that loss of whatever fruit produced that he gets in the immediate immediately, but rather future losses is to be taken in consideration. So, and he added, he says, criminal law no longer has more than survivals of the principle of restitution. Civil suit must now be filed by the offended party to recover damages, and then without regard to the biblical principle. So he's saying here, right, that yes, indeed, when there is neglect, when there is negligence and it causes loss to someone else, right, that loss is to be compensated, okay, duly compensated. And then there is also another section, part 4, which is Exodus 22:8, 9, 10, and 11. It's classified under breach of trust. Breach of trust. It says here, if the thief be not found, or it begins with verse 7. Verse 7, I've added in the context in your notes there. Page 4, right at the beginning. Okay. Page 4, right at the beginning. It says here, if a man shall deliver unto his neighbor money or staff to keep, and it be stolen out of the man's house, if the thief be found, let him pay double. So if a man deliver his neighbor's money or staff to keep, that means you are supposed to keep for someone his possessions, but in the process, whatever that was in your custody was stolen. If the thief be found, let him pay double. And now we go back to page 3. Yeah? Go back to page 3, right at the bottom. Okay. So we look at verse 8. If the thief be not found, then the master of the house shall be brought unto the judges to see whether he have put his hand into his neighbor's goods. So, if the thief cannot be found, then the one who is in charge of taking care of whatever that amount, he has to be answerable also. For all the manner of trespass, whether it be and for ox, for ass, for sheep, for raiment, or any manner of lost thing which another challengeth to be his, the cause of both parties shall come before the judges. And whom the judges shall condemn, he shall pay double unto his neighbor. So the judge will have to determine on a case-by-case basis whether there is sufficient evidence to show that the man who is the steward, right, had stolen. Verse 10, if a man deliver unto his neighbor an ass or an ox or a sheep or any beast to keep, and it die or it be hurt or driven away, no man seeing it, then shall an oath of the Lord be between them both, that he hath not put his hand into his neighbor's goods, and the owners of it shall accept thereof, and he shall not make it good. So here Spence classified this under dishonesty. Dishonesty. A person was responsible for items that he kept for another person if the item was lost or stolen while it was in his possession. He had to prove before the judges that he had been honorable in the matter. This was also true if he had kept an animal for his neighbor, or and the animal was hurt, lost, or if it died. Upon the vindication of the honor of the person, no restitution was made. So you see, if you want to take care of something, then you know that's an additional responsibility. We better make sure that we are able to, make sure that we have our keys and locks to ensure that you know whatever that we are holding for someone else is not lost. Even though, and when it is lost, even though we may not be the ones stealing, but the lost has, but the loss that is incurred has to be accounted for, okay, and that accounting would go back to the steward, right? The steward himself would have to answer. So here it says that this was also true if he had kept an animal for his neighbor and the animal was hurt, lost, or if it died. Upon the vindication of the honor of the person, no restitution was made. So the judge has to come in order to assess, investigate, understand, and then to determine the case. So Rash Duni, he analyzed, it says in Exodus 22:7-13, he says, responsibility is determined for goods held in custody. And he quoted this man called Rawlinson, and he who summarized this part of the law very well. He says, property deposited in the hands of another for safekeeping might be so easily embezzled by the trustee or lost through his negligence that some special laws were needed for its protection. Conversely, the trustee required to be safeguarded against incurring loss if the property entrusted to his care suffered damage or disappeared without fault of his. The Mosaic legislation provides for both. On the one hand, it required the trustee to exercise proper care and made him responsible or answerable for the loss if a thing entrusted to him was stolen and the thief not found. Embezzlement, it punished by requiring the trustee guilty of it to pay double. So if he's found to have stolen, then he has to make good. Make good of whatever that was stolen by paying double. On the other hand, in doubtful cases, it allowed the trustee to clear himself by an oath. So in a situation whereby there is no evidence, then the person's word would be counted. Okay. And in clear cases, to give proof that the loss had happened through unavoidable accident, okay, unavoidable accident. So all these are properly accounted. So you see, there is a lot of order in the way things are managed. Whatever that belongs to another one person is to be accounted for in the custody of another person. And you also notice that when Israel entered the Promised Land, God through Joshua allocated for them land for each family. They were all land owners. God assigned them, and this land were given to them for posterity. It belonged to them. Item 9, damages for stolen bailment for loss of borrowed property. That's Exodus 22, 7 to 15. So you will notice that there are some overlaps here and there, because they are viewed in different light. Right? In this case, under private law, we are speaking about the damages. Okay? How to account for the damages that were incurred. Right? The people were supposed to be in custody of certain things under their care, and then it was lost. So how to make good of all these things? So the Lord provided the law, and you see, the Lord is good to show us what He would want us to do. So if we would take time to search His word, take time to understand His will, you'll find that, you know, in the situations of life, God provides for us His wisdom. And it's for us to take time to know. Right? If you know it, then you are able to apply it rightly, and then you would have good relationships one with another. Rush Juni, he explains this portion. He says, if a man borrows and damages the property of another, he is liable for the damages. He has destroyed or harmed the property of another man, and is therefore guilty of theft. Restitution is mandatory. If the owner came to assist him voluntarily as a good neighbor, the damages is the owner's, because his property was damaged while under his own supervision. This is all the more true of he was working for hire, because his rental of his service with ox, ass, tractor, and any other equipment includes the wear and tear, maintenance, and damages to his working equipment. So it's quite interesting that as you consider the damages that is to be paid, oftentimes, as you think carefully what is to be paid, you are able to find that it is able to account for quite rightly in loss of use, loss of time, wear and tear, maintenance and damages. So double means that if a machine is damaged, you replace with another machine. That's what basically it means. Okay, so that the person is able to immediately be functional. Okay, by that repayment, by that replacement. Okay. Item 10, double damages for stealing. Right, verse 7 and verse 4 of Exodus 22. If a man shall deliver unto his neighbor money or staff to keep, and it be stolen out of the man's house, if the thief be found, let him pay double. If the thief be certainly found in his hand alive, whether it be ox or sheep, he shall restore double. Okay. Rush Juni, again I quote him, he says, if the thief cannot make restitution, he is to be sold into slavery in order to satisfy the requirement of the restitution. So if he's supposed to pay a fine and he can't afford to pay the fine, then he has to be involved with some kind of labor that would enable him by that labor generate enough to compensate for whatever that was lost. So you see here that it is great deterrent right? For a person to steal. You not only lose what you have, but you have to pay double. Why not, you know, just do an honest day's work. Right? Whatever that you have is yours. Whatever that you earn is yours to keep. No one can take it, in a sense, legitimately from you. Double damages for trespass, item 11. For all manner of trespass, that's verse 9 of Exodus 22, whether it be for ox or ass, for sheep or raiment, for any manner of lost thing which another challenges to be his, the cause of both parties shall come before the judges, and whom the judges shall condemn, he shall pay double unto his neighbor. Okay, so here is the law of double damages. The judge will come in, right? Whatever that was lost as a result of one man trespassing the property or the into another man's property, then whatever that was lost, if it's found, right, that that neighbor has in his trespass has caused the loss, then he is to pay double. He is to pay double. And it's interesting that Leviticus 19 verses 20 to 22 is also classified there. It says here, and whosoever lieth carnally with a woman that is a bond maid betrothed to a husband, and be not at all redeemed, nor freedom given her, she shall be scourged. They shall not be put to death, because she was not free. And he shall bring his trespass offering unto the Lord, and unto the house of the tabernacle of the congregation, even a ram for a trespass offering, and the priest shall make an atonement for him with the ram of the trespass offering before the Lord for his sin which he had done, and the sin which he had done shall be forgiven him. So you see that if there is a commitment of a sin, a trespass, the person who commits the trespass, the sin, has to repent. Repent first. Then you'll find that, yeah, all this would make good. Then there is forgiveness. If there's no repentance, then where do you find forgiveness? Right? But when Jesus died on the cross for our sins, how can we be accepted by God? By our repentance. It means we come to Him knowing that we have done wrong and that He had paid the price for our sins, and then we receive forgiveness. But if there's no repentance, the heart is still hard, there's no forgiveness. Part 12, double damages for breach of trust. For all manner of trespass, whether it be ox or ass or sheep, raiment, or any manner of lost thing which another challenges to be his, the cause of both parties shall come before the judge, and whom the judges shall condemn, he shall pay double unto his neighbor. And so this is that section, quite a lengthy section for these 15 verses, classified, divided into various parts concerning how damages are to be paid for things lost. Then it's also classified under private law and civil law, these situations of theft. Under section A of private law, which is civil law, okay, and it's given there, item 7, from item 7 onwards, miscellaneous contracts, verse 8 to 15, and item 8, damages for breach of contract. Okay. So here, when certain losses are made, right, whereby one man gives to another person to take care of his things, and it is done via a written contract, right, that okay, this is now under your care, and this is for you to, this is what you are supposed to do. And then if you have not done it, then here it is classified in the, here under contracts and damages to be made good. Okay? Verse 9, for all manner of trespass, whether it be ox or ass, for sheep, for raiment, or for any manner of lost thing, which another challenges to be his, the cause of both parties shall come before the judges, and whom the judges shall condemn, he shall pay double unto his neighbor. Okay, so here is classified under private law and under criminal law. Okay, this next item, crimes against property. Okay, so here, when we talk about theft, you see that there is a section that is classified under public law, which we have seen, which is under the subheading of courts and legal procedure, and the subheading of courts, the items under damages. Then the second portion under private law, which is classified as civil law, when we speak about contracts. And thirdly, it is classified under private law in section B, criminal law. Okay, when this theft is to be dealt with, whoever steals is to be dealt with as one who does so with the intention of stealing. Okay, so the first item is theft, which we have mentioned. The second is burglary, burglary. Okay, item 2, or verse 2 of Exodus 22, it says, if a thief be found breaking up and be smitten that he die, there shall no blood be shed for him. If the sun be risen upon him, there shall be blood shed for him. For if he shall make full restitution, if he have nothing, and then he be sold for his theft. Okay, now here is explained, burglary is explained under item 6, okay, which is killing a burglar. That means the thief that stole is found out by the owner, and then because it is in the night, he's killed. Then the owner has no, that means the owner is not at fault, okay, when it is in the night. But if it's in the daytime, then the person who killed, okay, that person who catch the man, it's not supposed to kill the person, right? Daytime you can see who he is, so he's supposed to be caught and then apprehended and brought, right, to be sentenced. Okay. Okay, so here, again I quote Rush Dooney, he says, theft could involve problems with respect to defense against the thief. Okay, someone steal from you, and you were defending whatever that you have to prevent the burglar, the thief, from stealing. A housekeeper at night can be legitimately killed by householders to defend their property. So it is not wrong, right, for a thief to be killed if he's being caught. Right, so night time, a person tried to steal, and you know, It is part of the legitimately, there's no reason to assume that this breaking does not cover the barn and today a garage. It says, in daylight, however, the killing of a thief except for self-defense is manslaughter. Okay, so in the daylight, right, when everything is clear, it's an offense. Okay. The thief can then be identified and apprehended, so that this in itself is protection. Okay, so you know who the thief is already, so the thief cannot get away. But in the night, you're chasing the person. It's in the dark. You know, you may be manhandling the person, and you try to stop the person. And then if something happens, the owner is not culpable. And then, okay, so we said that under criminal law, there's crimes against property. There is theft, burglary, there's arson. Okay, arson. Arson is also described here. Verse 5 and 6 says, if a man shall cause a field or vineyard to be eaten, and shall put in his beast, and shall feed in another man's field, on the man, the best of his own, and the best of his own vineyard, shall he make restitution. If fire break out and catch in thorns, so that the stack of corns be, or the standing corn or the field be consumed therewith, he that kindled the fire shall surely make restitution. Okay. Here I quote again Rush Guni. He says, theft is not only the expropriation legally or illegally of another man's property against his will or by fraud, but also the destruction of property or value of property by any willful act or by accident. Thus, to destroy a man's house by arson is theft. But it is also theft if the house is burnt down by carelessness. Okay, negligent, in other words, we said. Okay. To damage a man's automobile is to rob him of its value. In this area, restitution has been made more or less made mandatory by the insurance laws of various states, because inflation weakens or destroys the values of paper currencies, and inflation too is very definitely a form of theft. Now here he's speaking about theft in the modern sense. Okay, and during the Adult Sunday School this Sunday, we're going to study that. Okay, under Vision 6, the woman who was hidden in the ephah, and we see this 10 years ago during the Lehman Brother crisis. Remember what we call the subprime crisis? What happened was that all these mortgage-backed securities, people's houses, men, those who have their houses, bought their houses and they borrowed. Okay, the banks who lend them the money, okay, took whatever that was that borrowed sum, which is itself is like an empty sum, okay, and package it and sell it in some other, under some other financial instruments, okay, that a person has no way to determine where the value of what he has bought come from. And you realize that if they trace it back, trace back to all these loans, which the owner who borrowed have no way to pay. So there were many who bought, remember those security notes, bank security notes, and those who bought, suddenly the value becomes zero, right? Because it takes just a little bit of loss to trigger, because what this is what we call leveraging. Leveraging. So they leverage so much that just a little loss will cause the whole lump sum to fall. And that is quite scary. And this is the what we call fraudulent system that we are seeing today. And well, we said that time of crisis can come. 10 years ago, it happened. Today, the situation is much, much worse. Many, many times worse. And a lot of warnings are coming out. That we can't hold on anymore. We can't hold on anymore. So, this is theft. Theft on a global scale. We're going to talk about it more during our Doubt Sunday School. Crimes, so we said that there is arson, and then there is trespass. Okay? For all manner of trespass, whether it be ox or ass or sheep or raiment, or for any manner of lost thing or any which another challenges to be his, the cause of both parties shall come before the judges, and whom the judges shall condemn, he shall pay double unto his neighbor. Numbers 15:29 is also quoted here under trespass, criminal trespass. Ye shall have one law for him that sinneth through ignorance, both for him that is born among the people of Israel and for the stranger that sojourneth among them. So that's item five, crimes against property. And then item six, crimes for which no punishment was inflicted, no punishment, okay? And that involves the killing of the burglar. Remember the thief who came and steal in the night, and the owner tried to protect his own property, tried to stop the thief, and the thief got killed as a result. No punishment for the owner. Again, I quote Rush Rooney. Theft could involve problems with respect to defense against the thief. A housekeeper at night can be legitimately killed by householders to defend their property. It is a part of their legitimately, it's a part, there is no reason to assume that this breaking does not cover the barn or today a garage. In the daylight, however, the killing of a thief except for self-defense is manslaughter. So basically what he's saying here is that, well, in the night, if he's killed, then no blood shall be shed for him, meaning that it is in self-defense. Okay, but in the daytime, then it is called manslaughter. Okay, so you distinguish here, hear the difference. If bailman dies or is destroyed, a man deliver his neighbor an ass or ox or sheep or any beast to keep, and it die, it be hurt or driven away, no man seeing it, then shall an oath of the Lord be between them both, that he hath not put his hand into his neighbor's goods, and the owner of it shall accept thereof, and shall not make it good. Loss of hired property. If a man borrow aught of his neighbor, and it be hurt or die, the owner thereof being with it, he shall make it good. But if the owner thereof be with it, he shall not make it good. If it be an hired thing, it came for his hire. So, loss of a hired property. Okay. And then item seven, Item 7, modes of punishment. Modes of punishment. Multiple restitution rests on the principle of justice. Sheep are capable of a high rate of reproduction and have use not only as meat but also as means of their wool for clothing as well as for other uses. To steal a sheep is to steal the present and future value of a man's property. Here, quoting Rush Juni, he says, the ox requires a higher rate of restitution, fivefold, because the ox was trained to pull carts, to plow, and was used for a variety of farm tasks. The ox, therefore, had not only the value of its meat and its usefulness, but also the value of its training, in that training an ox for work was a task requiring time and skill. It thus commanded a higher rate of restitution. Clearly, a principle of restitution is in evidence here. Restitution must calculate only the present and future value of a stolen thing, but also the specialized skill involved in its replacement. Okay, so here we talk about how to punish, and then compensation. This is it. The Lord help us.